Welcome to the 8th edition of the NIUA ADB IHC Urban Dialogue. I believe few of you might have been regular in these dialogues, and we probably has one of the less number of participants this evening for reasons, maybe rain or Friday evening, whatever. But so quickly, let me introduce both the speakers for this evening. Dr. M. Satish Kumar, who teaches in the School of Geography, Archaeology, Paleoecology at the Queen's University, Belfast, is the lead speaker for this evening. You would have seen a title, Titanic Quarter, Redevelopment, Belfast Proposal for Global Investment. So he is going to talk about a work, interesting work, which he has been associated as part of the Urban Renewal Program in the city of Belfast. Dr. Satish has been in teaching at the Queen's University Belfast for the last 15 years. His area of expertise is post-colonial studies, especially looking at the economic development of the post-colonial areas in focusing on South Asia. I was also fortunate to be associated with him because I did my PhD. He was my PhD advisor. So that was a great privilege to actually be here and welcome him for this on this evening. Alan Grimard is the UN Habitat's country focal point for India. Alan has been here less than 6 months now, but has been taking an active interest in developing India's preparation for Habitat 3, as well as enabling the latent energy, enabling the latent interest in the institutions in India to engage with the UN Habitat. So we have been having a lot of discussions with Alan to see what way NIUA can actually to capitalize on the new urban agenda and related themes. So I welcome both of them to, and I would now like to request Dr. Satish Kumar to make his presentation, and subsequently Alan would start his deliberations. Thank you so much.
So anyway, thank you very much. I was thinking more about when I was thinking about this topic and what I was going to speak about it. I decided that I have to say something about the Titanic, which was built in Belfast, from my eyes, rather than from the eyes of James Cameron, who made the movie and got a lot of Oscars. I'm not expecting Oscars for this talk today, but I'm expecting that you will be a bit more enlightened about how the Titanic really came about and what was the story behind the Titanic, what was the story behind the people who built the Titanic, and what happened subsequently. So I'll try and weave in some elements of this particular theme as best as possible within the time frame. But before that, I thought I should start by saying that I really want to thank Ajit and Devjani and Dr. Jagan Shah as well for providing an opportunity to share some of these ideas, which I know is quite relevant and is quite significant from the point of view of regeneration and redevelopment. And also, I'm grateful to Alan for taking time out to be the discussant. It is said that Titanic was made in Belfast by an Irish. So Titanic was made in Belfast by the Irish and left the port of Southampton and was sunk by the British on the icy seas of Atlantic, according to the blogs of the region. So bear in mind that I'm already talking about a political conflict, which is becoming more and more relevant when we're looking at this region. The RMS Titanic sinking off the coast of Newfoundland on April the 15th, 1912, was one of the most infamous maritime disasters in the history of shipping. So I want you to keep a track of that as well. More than 1,500 lives perished in the icy waters, made live by James Cameron, 1997 blockbuster, Titanic, and winning numerous Oscars. Okay. In fact, when I look at this whole period, years since then, while every effort was made to erase the memory of this infamous ship in Belfast, it persisted in the collective memories of those nation states who lost precious citizens in this disaster. How did I get to know about Titanic? When I came to Belfast, a friend of mine who met me in one of the pubs decided that he would take me on a tour of Belfast about 15, 18 years ago. And going into this spot here, it was like a dead land, hardly any souls. And he said, you know, if you have never driven a car, you can drive here, no one will challenge you, because this place is a derelict land, useless, dead land. And this is the place where they built the Titanic. I just want to show you images. The images that you find here, the drawings, the architectural drawings was there. People perceived of a new way of looking at Belfast, and they brought out many forms of architectural designs to say how can they change the perception of Belfast as a conflict-ridden city. The picture here is of many ships like the Titanic, which left the ports of Belfast and moved on to do incredible shipping trade across the world. So as I said, that the collective memory of the people of Belfast about the Titanic was still quite strong, especially those who lost precious citizens in the disaster. Perhaps you may know, I want to ask you a question. How many of you know how many Asians were there in the Titanic? Any thoughts? Kaun banega crorepati? I can't give you the answers. How many Asians were there? Make a guess. One, two, three, any of you guys?
Six.
Any thoughts? 1,500 people died.
100.
There was two Asians. Okay? There was one Gujarati who was quite smart. And there was one Japanese. The Gujarati did not take the entire journey and got off in the earlier port. So he survived the Titanic disaster. The Japanese went on to take the journey and he survived the disaster, only to be condemned as a coward by the Japanese society and lived his life, rest of his life, in ignominy and sadness. Okay? So again, you can see the human story that comes through for those who survived and those who didn't survive. The city's history is associated with this ship. But this ship, too, was ignored and suppressed. So there's an interesting dynamics of why the city's heritage was suppressed and ignored. The reasons were as follows. And if, as I said, I'll come back to that in 2 seconds. The reasons were as follows. The fact that the disaster happened on the eve of the First World War, okay, also explained the longevity of its collective memory, but also emerged as a, as we say in Hindi, the lakshan of what was going to come about during the First World War. The slaughter, the disaster, the destruction was explained to the sinking of the Titanic. Okay, so you can see that there was all these elements that was being discussed. If they had employed, and I always say, I ask the question, that if they had employed the Purohits to decide about the particular time, the auspicious time for the launch of the Titanic, perhaps the disasters could have been avoided. But this is a conjecture that astrologers could be tasked in India to figure out. It is a pity that astrology did not reach the global acceptance as that of the yoga today. Here's another food for thought for global India brand seeking suture for domestic and global afflictions. In fact, when the Titanic was launched, and if you look at the images, I've seen some of the images of the Titanic being launched. As I say, and I use this, I said, Narel ke jagah pe, whiskey ka bottle de diya, and tor ke, on that hull of the Titanic, which annoyed the celestial gods, koi samjhane wala nahi tha wahan pe. Really speaking. Okay, so when you launch a ship, you break a whiskey bottle. You don't break a Narel there. So there are all these explanations that we can get in the context of the Titanic. Secondly, the cause of why this collective memory was suppressed and was ignored. The sectarian nature of the industry was a cause of concern. The best jobs, the best positions in the Titanic industry was reserved for people from only one community, the Protestant community. The Catholic community was completely ignored. Most of them worked in the ships, in the foundries, working in the most difficult jobs, the unskilled jobs, even though they had skills. Some of them, if they were lucky enough, could become carpenters, but they could never become the directors or managers or regional directors. Okay, so there was the sectarian nature of the employment which existed. There was a religious apartheid caste system which was strictly enforced not only on a colour basis but by religious divide, even though they acknowledged the name Jesus Christ as the Saviour. So during this period, one could never observe a member of the Catholic community attaining exalted positions in the industry. This is equally true of the bureaucracy, and it was only in the late 1970s that the Catholic could become a senior bureaucrat and a senior position. So that's the level of discrimination that existed. This was true of the shipbuilding yard, which was headquartered in Harland and Wolff in East Belfast. The saying among the community was that children from the Protestant families followed their fathers, their uncles, cousins and grandfathers into the shipping industry as a hereditary occupation. Thereby becoming welders and fitters, etc. With the rise of sectarianism, with the rise of education, the skills, acquiring skills became the only means by which there could be social mobility, economic mobility, occupational mobility for the Catholics in the community in Northern Ireland. Okay, so there's 150 years and a 50 years conflict that existed between the Catholics and Protestants in Northern Ireland. And that was primarily because of this reason of sectarianism, of discrimination. But things have changed since then. With the global economic downturn, industry shipbuilding has gone into decline. The whole industry has moved to China and Korea and other places. So it has become derelict. And of course, the jobs which are assured to the particular community all through 70, 80 years of history have disappeared, have dried up. So what we find today, and I'm just taking a quick footnote to what I've been saying till now, what we find today is that in the universities where I teach, and other education institutions, majority of the key positions are held by Catholics because they have built their human capital. Of all the suppressions, they have built that human capital, and today they are quite free to move very rapidly into those ranks which have been available to them. On the contrary, the Protestant communities have lost out in a big way in terms of skill development. There's no motivation, there's no skills, and there's no development. So that's one side of the story as well. So now I want to do is to fast forward very rapidly. And today Belfast and the Titanic Quarters is known for the Game of Thrones. You can see me sitting on the Game of Thrones. This is a real throne. Okay. So Game of Thrones have become the iconic image, a regenerated iconic image of Belfast, of Titanic Quarters. So you talk about the sixth episode. How many of you watched the Game of Thrones here? Are you there? You are. I take my students on the field trip to the Game of Thrones. I have a condition to the students that HBO tells me very categorically, don't take pictures. But you can't stop the students from taking pictures because they carry it in their phone. I have only one condition, don't put it in the Facebook. Because the moment you put it in the Facebook, HBO will track you down and they'll hound you for your money for the rest of your life. So you have the choice of taking pictures but keep it for your personal consumption. So these are approved pictures by the HBO to be allowed to take in. So I can show it in the public domain. We were there for the sixth episode, the last episode, and it was quite exciting because I have just learned that this character here, do you know the character here? Those who watched the picture? Yes. What's the name? That's right. Her name is now the most popular name for every girl child born in Belfast now.
Really?
Yes. Because it's generous. It has suddenly become, again, a name which everyone wants the child to have. So you can see the role of creative media, culture, how it is transcending, moving across and changing the lives of the people. I want to take a few minutes to come back to this. And as I said, fast forward, the Good Friday Agreement comes into existence in 1996. And a peace is installed. Power sharing among the Catholics and the Protestant communities happen on the completion of 100 years since the maritime tragedy. So the peace process comes about exactly 100 years after the tragedy. The city of Belfast takes the center stage for this commemoration. The question was, why was this significant? The city was determined to excavate this significant heritage from the embers of conflict and loss. The memory of the city in the construction of the city had to be celebrated and reinstated as part of this collective memory and nostalgia. So for the first time, instead of the shipbuilding, the Harland and Wolff, the city becomes the focus. And here is the change that takes place. That urban development, urban regeneration became city-focused. because everything had to be geared towards the urban center, the city of Belfast. This was achieved with the conceptualization of the Titanic Museum, which was opened to the public in April 2012. A memorial plaque was also inaugurated formally in the Belfast City Hall premises, at that time documenting the names of those who perished in the Titanic, both the Catholics and the Protestants. Okay? This was the making and acknowledgement of a shared history in New Northern Ireland. From a century of demise and tragedy was the transformation into a century of shared celebration of the skill, the tenacity, and the innovativeness of the people of Belfast, and indeed of Ireland, in forging such a transnational enterprise as the RMS Titanic and the White Liners. The former Sinn Féin Lord Mayor, Niall O'Donoghue, stated that the reason why it took the city so long to commemorate its citizens' skills was because the memory was too painful and the loss too personal. Yet others blamed this historic amnesia due to the sense of shame, despair, and of failure arguably experienced by the city of Harland and Wolff with the monumental disaster of the sinking of the Titanic. The sectarian nature of employment was also cited as a reason for this collective amnesia for hundreds of years. Now, Belfast has taken charge of its history in order to write its own script, in order to write its own narrative. As I said, some of you are surprised that the Titanic was made in Belfast, not in London, not in Southampton, not in Cork. It was built in Belfast. So I really urge you to come and see it yourself. Heritage was given a soul, a hyder, and focused on the incredible effort to resuscitate its glory. Okay, let me move on. This was an attempt, and I want to now move on, as I said, to look at the change that took place. And this character is important. Why? I'll come to it in a few seconds. As an architect, as a planner, as a person who transformed the way we look at heritage. This was an attempt to economically regenerate the city and to positively capitalize on the commercial possibilities and opportunities of fostering heritage and cultural tourism. So there are two elements, fostering heritage and cultural tourism. It was a rechristening of the Harland and Wolff space, or the Queen's Island, as a wider Titanic Quarter that scripted its success as a space for global investment. History, culture, and heritage was adroitly repackaged to present a new emergent urban entity, which included hotels, educational institutions, covering 185 acres of Harland and Wolff shipyard, the derelict shipyard. This was a clear and successful attempt to rebrand the city as a cultural heritage capital. The Titanic Museum, located in the Queen's Island beside the Belfast Lock and the graving docks of Harland and Wolff. This was an arrangement of a glittering and innovative architecture with several thousand three-dimensional silver anodized aluminium plates crafted in the likes of five ships' prows within a jutting towards the sky and built at the same height as the original Titanic of 126 feet. So the poster that Ajit provided us is actually a replica of the Titanic, 126 feet high, trying to recall what the Titanic was like. It was designed to reflect the past that was displayed in the inside, with the hope that the city can be exorcised of its demons from the past of prosperity. £1 million was spent on the project. And it was believed, and it is a fact now, that £1 million was spent on this project, and it has done for Belfast what Guggenheim did for Bilbao. Okay, so that's the parallel we get. In terms of the city of Belfast, when you look at the city of Belfast, and also when you look at the Titanic Museum, what we find is the state-of-art innovative technology of engineering, of manufacturing. The skills, and I'll show you very clear images of the transitions that took place. The Titanic Museum became the most expensive museum in Europe and attracts close to 1 million visitors annually. 1 million visitors. So I know the Honorable Prime Minister wants to make those changes, to bring about changes to India, to regenerate the heritage sector. And what I'm trying to propose is that it's the only way you could do this is by being really seriously taking heritage to its next available aspect. So, Titanic, sorry, where am I? I'll just go back. I'm going to give you a background to it before I... Okay. So the direct landscape of the historic Harland and Wolff is being gradually transformed in phases since Belfast as the city moves forward. Indeed, the boom town of Belfast of industrial landscape set the foundation of city's prosperity between remembering and beyond forgetting the sectarian agenda of the past. The Titanic Museum itself was conceived by this Texan-born architect, Eric Kuhn, known for the development of the Blue Water Shopping Center in Kent. And he believed on this particular philosophy, which I like to highlight for students as well as for colleagues here. He said, and it was his belief, that there is an absolute integration between art, architecture, gardens, and the ethos of culture, adding that modernism did pretty well in destroying this intrinsic link. He was dead against the concept of a tourist trap. It's no use having a tourist trap. You may build a heritage center to gather tourists, but it does nothing to the economy. People come and go. So it has to be much more integrated, much more sustainable. So Kuhn also believed it was his vision that restoration was essential to tell the story of heritage and culture. Without restoration, there is no heritage, there's no culture. So these two elements became critical for the success of the Titanic Quarters and the continuous success of the Titanic Quarters. So he said that he wanted to celebrate the lives of 50,000 workers, 50,000 workers who worked the blood, sweat, and tears in the construction of not just Titanic, but all the great ships that were built at that period of time. He saw huge potential of the derelict docklands as a canvas to design the regeneration project. The 75 hectares of brownfield land was to be regenerated to provide 20,000 jobs in mixed-use quarters, thereby allowing a blending of heritage and the aspirations of the community and the city. This derelict land was good for nothing and was contaminated with arsenic and lead as a legacy of the past industrial shipbuilding history. Soil stabilization measures were undertaken to prevent leaching of arsenic and lead into the lake, into the lock, as we call it. So there were many phases, a couple of phases of it. Just to give you an idea, this is how the Titanic Quarters looked at the time when the Titanic was being built. And you can see the whole complex, everything was there. And it gradually deteriorated into nothingness over a period of time. How do you know the period? Look at the cars, which gives you some idea, indication of that period of time. There were also, we found there were elements, in fact, almost the Titanic signature project incorporating historic slipways for the Titanic, which is filled with deadly asbestos, among others, ensuring development of the site, which was equidistant from the city center, facilitating both the local community, the visiting tourist, and ensured economic sustainability. So unless we are able to bring the community together, unless we are able to integrate the community development, the tourism development, and the economic development, we cannot have a successful regeneration project. This was the construction of the Titanic. You can see the hull, and this is from the historic archival pictures of how the Titanic looked like. As I said, the derelict, the complete barrenness of this place, as I said, you can have rats and ghosts running through this place historically. And you can see, even the place where they had the drawing boards, where the Titanic was drawn, which was constructed, all of them was in complete shambles. Today, everything has changed. They have maintained the facades, and I'm going to go through these slides very quickly, so they get an image of what it looked like and what it looks like now. Okay? These were diagrams made of that particular Titanic Museum's structure, and you can see how the process of the culmination, the organization of the ideas around the Titanic. Again, the big hull, this is the place where the Titanic was brought in, the slipway, and you can see it was in complete derelict. Early days, when I first came to Belfast, we were taken on the buses to show the heritage sites. And they would say, oh, let's go there, and it would take about 2 minutes. People would just go in there, it's nothing to see, it's all rocks and that sort of identity. But today it's changed. It's changed and it brings money to the community. Look at the beautiful architectures, the Victorian architectures remaining completely derelict. That is the state of affairs, even in the ship room, and completely barrenness for all the... By the way, that, if you see, is the Harland and Wolff. Okay, and Harland and Wolff, what is interesting about the Harland and Wolff is that as apparently people have gone to the space have seen that even from the space. Yep. So you can see how far you can see it. It's a heritage structure. Again, giving you an idea of what how bad the places would look like. In the historic times, again, people making the drawings for the ships, etc. Just giving you images. That's the Harland and Wolff, again, I mentioned. People going to work in the everyday life of the people, the community. And it attracted a huge amount of migration from the rural areas into the city. And they had to be provided with accommodation, etc. Today, that's Titanic Quarters. You have Snow Patrol, you have the MTV Awards, everything happening in this space. This derelict space has transformed. You can see in T13, there is this space available now, which is purpose-built. Almost all the key programs for the television, movies for Hollywood, are all shot here. And they use it as stills for immediate transmission. Major concerts are held here. Major sports events are held here. Extreme sports events are held here. So that's a space which has transformed the Titanic Quarters tremendously. Again, as I said, it was all based on a vision, based on an idea, based on the utilization and planning of the spaces at all times, at all levels. You can see some of the sets, the sets which are constructed for many of the soaps. And if you watch very carefully, you'll find that some of them appears from these sites as well. So what is it doing to the people of the Belfast? What is it doing to the community? What is it doing to the city of Belfast? It's creating huge amount of revenues. And I want to take a few minutes now to talk about the concept of the regeneration of the Titanic Quarters. It's based on this particular dimension: exciting architecture, world-class public realm, energizing the waterfront, and bringing heritage to life. It is living heritage. It's not a dead heritage. It's a living heritage. Learning and discovering, living, relaxing, connecting, working, tourism, and visiting. That's the sort of vision statement which became the essence of what Titanic Quarters stands for. And it has become a major landmark in Europe, across the world. Some of the changes that have taken place, that's the whole scale. Those who are keen on the details of the maps and of the regeneration sites, which gives you an indication of how that red mark, that was a space that was regenerated, and they're constantly reclaiming land as well to bring in more developments to the space in phases. This is called the Queen's Island. You also have an understanding of the residential blocks, how they're looking at the residential blocks, the hotels, the offices, and the car showrooms, etc., etc. So it's complete landscaping in innovative ways. Where once we build ships, the great ships of the world, that's the Titanic Quarters, we are now having this tremendous redevelopment of the region, of the spaces. So the opportunities are huge. Regeneration is huge. Harland and Wolff is still iconic. We still keep it there. We don't want to blow it up. We want to retain its identity. But the changes are happening at a rapid way. It's called the Land of the Giants. Rory McIlroy is also from the same part of the world. Okay? And we have the iconic figures of Rory. So he says, if you can dream it, you can do it. And the whole idea is to be able to dream what you want to do for your heritage, how you want to organize your heritage and make it happen. So the dream makers have come here. Today, it's not just shipbuilding. You also have the Game of Thrones here. And people have asked, why is it that the Game of Thrones have come there? Why did HBO come to this site? That's the Titanic Museum, Harland and Wolff. And you have the Game of Thrones, the actual Game of Thrones. Why did they come there? The question is, they've come there because we are able to provide tremendous space for making movies, for making episodes for Hollywood. But Hollywood could go to any other place in the world. Why did they come to Belfast? Because we gave them cheap land. We gave them very good rates. But at the same time, what people forgot is that Belfast and Titanic Quarters provides one of the fastest fiber optic cable network that you could transmit at nanoseconds within, as soon as the shooting is completed, they can transmit it straight into Hollywood for the editing purposes. So that facility is unique, high speed. The speed is absolutely mind-boggling in terms of what they can achieve. So as I said, the Titanic, the stars, the cast and thousands of 1910, that's the life of the people. The people still are significant, and today we are focusing on how to improve the skills of the people of that region, of that period. So where are we today? That's the Titanic Quarters, giving you the idea. If you look at the changes, it gives you some ideas of how the development has taken place and what new emphasis are being made in terms of the airports, in terms of the gateway cities, in terms of the waterfront hall. It's a cultural capital. It's a media, creative media capital. You name it, it's all happening. And investment is pouring in, time and the crucial point, as I said, is the 1 mile distance between the city centre and the Titanic Quarters. So the idea being that anyone can go to the Titanic and see the Titanic Quarters. So 1 million visitors doesn't happen overnight. It happens because people have taken the efforts for that. It is a connected place. Look at the connected place. Okay, everything is connected by roads, by airports, everything. It gives you an idea of the scale of change. I'm not going to go into too much details about the links, both airport and other links, but just gives you an idea of how people can commute from any part of the city into the Titanic Quarters and take advantage of it. The Belfast Rapid Transport System is one of the ideas that they have. So we see in total about 1,000 people are living there, 4,000 people are working there, 15,000 are studying, and 1 million is visiting. Okay, aspiration-wise, as I said, the fiber optic connectivity is massive. Kelvin, the idea of the Kelvin link between Northern Ireland and North America, direct access, okay, massive. You can almost see the backhaul fiber access to global internet exchanges. So the next generation is to really open up and also provide fiber to home. The sort of digital transformation, the innovation is coming through continuously in this part of the world. What are the key areas of investment here? Science and technology, financial services, tourism, creative media, education and recreation. The site contains the Northern Ireland Science Park, which helps to promote partnership between higher education institutions and the business communities. The Belfast Institute for Further Education and the Science Park are all designed to attract global investments, interfacing between education, industry and incubation centres. Knowledge and skills for regeneration and creative economy becomes the basis to deliver global competitiveness and critical investments in return. This brings in high-tech, knowledge-based sectors attracting talent and global investments. I've looked at some of the figures. It's quite interesting to see that Belfast contributed to the economic growth of the state with a rising gross value added of 47% between 1995 and 2001, employing more than 300,000 people. So the change is tremendous in terms of gross value added, in terms of the income generation, and in terms of the people who are coming there. So let me very quickly, how much time do I have? 10-15 minutes. Okay, I'm just going to keep a quick overview and wind up things that I think are important and then just leave it open for the questions. Okay. So the initial phases of development, again, I've gone into it. I'm not going to go back into explaining. This is the Abercorn Basin, one of the places where the ships were able to come out, the Abercorn Basin, and it's been converted into this beautiful. Okay. So the planning was important. Conceiving the plan, but also organizing the plan is very important, execution. There was no political interference. It was completely given to the people, to the builders, to make it happen, and to make it happen in a realistic sense. The Gateway Hotel is only one of the few hotels which have come up. There are more hotels being planned. Premier Inn is going to come in, has already come in, but other hotels are being planned as well. The City Bank, the city offices are located there. Why? Because the three universities provide the skills, the IT skills, the technological skills for investment in these places. The Public Records Office is like the archives, National Archives of Delhi. This is the Public Records Office, which has massive amount of resources, materials, information about the heritage, which is housed here, about the Titanic quarters and about other heritage of the island. Okay, located there. Science and technology, as I mentioned, the science park, it's all located here. It's all happening here. Okay. Cybersecurity, key areas in cybersecurity, information technologies are being organized in these places. The metropolitan colleges provide further educational opportunities, skill development within that same regeneration space. So you can see it's getting integrated, bringing things together. And Hollywood, as I said, comes to the Titanic with the particularly with the Game of Thrones and others. So 2012, that's the Titanic, the Hollywood side of it. The expansion of the site is becoming more and more important. The world's largest Titanic visitor attraction, which is now the Titanic Quarters, from different images to give you an idea. Public space, huge amount of space for running concerts, programs, musical events in the open spaces as well. I just want to take a few seconds to show you this image here. Do any of you know about this image? It's a sand artist who actually designed this particular image on the sand. The theme is called the Wish Ground Art Project. And basically, he picked up a child from one of the from the city of Belfast, who we thought would be the most iconic face. And you can almost see this image when you're coming down by plane into Belfast. So again, all sorts of creative art gets into these spaces, and utilizing these spaces becomes more and more attractive. So this Wish project became really central to providing the aspirations, the wish of the people to become united to the global agenda, to really think about the global agenda. Events like water sports, cable, etc., are being organized. Again, you have the world-class extreme sports events. Fascinating, absolutely incredible. In terms of not just the actual sports, but also using it as props for various programs and events for the TV and music. You also have the musical concert, the cultural flagships, international dance festivals, Conquest of Happiness, all sorts of theatre programs which are run in the Titanic Quarters. Live music, MTV Awards, as I mentioned. Right, and also they have the colour run, where they bring in some form of holi, but adapted to the requirements of the people living there, and it's for charity purposes. So you can see that even a part of our own culture gets assimilated in this particular event. And it's not just one community or in terms of extreme one element of the community, but all communities get a participation. The Giro d'Italia, the famous cycling race, also took place here, again hosted by the city of Belfast. The number of companies, you can locate Polaris from India, located there. Okay, you have all these huge companies having their base in Belfast, and it's quite significant. Tech Mahindra, Polaris, almost all the HCL technologies, all of them are located in these places here in the Titanic Quarters. So by 2025, there's huge aspirations to increase the number of people living there, to increase the number of people working there, and to increase the number of people visiting the place. So what's next? The next phase is to put more investment in those spaces, heritage spaces, which we could not do anything in the first phase or the second phase. So now they're looking for more investments to go into these spaces, to transform these spaces. And there's quite a generous support from the Heritage Lottery Fund, from the UK Heritage Lottery Fund, and other funds as well. So these are some of the aspirations that they have. The idea of having an Olympic house, and the full planning provisions have been provided. So these are the sort of spaces that are being discussed. The financial quarters, financial service center, is also being visualized in these spaces. It's become an incubation center. The media campuses is, again, the idea of creative media hub appearing in this region, expanding it forward. I'm not going to go into the Take-Two studios is important because Hollywood is expanding its activities in this region. And they're putting in a huge amount of investment to expand these spaces. Take-Three, again, looking at the Titanic Quarter studios as well. The forgotten giant, what happens to this forgotten giant? How are we going to utilize this forgotten giant? Those are some of the questions that are being asked. The shed is very important because, again, it's a flexible space. The shed has become a flexible space where you can utilize it for all sorts of events. It's not something which is fixed, but you can actually manipulate that space for events. So again, the demand for investors looking for flexibility in terms of planning itself, in terms of production itself. So the idea being to live, to share, and the Grand Central, the whole idea of living and sharing together as a community, not one for the Protestant and not one for the Catholic. It's all communities together. It's all the diasporas, excuse me, together. Just giving you ideas of the new potential development areas. That's the sort of images that they have of what they can do, what they would like to do. Sports and leisure centers. So, we have the image of the Titanic Museum based on the actuals and recreated to make it most attractive. So the extraordinary things can happen here, we say. The question is what happens next. So let me end by saying that, really speaking, when we look at the whole Titanic regeneration project, it has transformed the lives of the people. It has increased the aspirations of the people. But there is always a question that is nagging. How do we bring the community? Because people can come from Hollywood, people can come from everywhere else. How do you bring the community together? Because there are people who used to have all the jobs, all the skills, they have gone. The skills and jobs have gone. The level of suicides have increased. People have lost hope because they don't have any more jobs in the shipbuilding industry. But they don't even have the skills. They don't have the education. They don't know what education is. So they have been left out of this global transformation that's taking place. So there is the need for us to think about the community much more in order to have lasting impact. And in order for lasting impact to be sustainable, the communities have to be given the voice in the heritage, reconstruction, and development. I'll stop there and I'll leave it for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar, for giving an overview of the development process of Titanic Quarter and also explaining the emotional as well as the socio-cultural reasons behind the whole process of urban renewal. I would now like to invite Harland Rimar to quickly respond to this presentation.
Thanks, Dr. Kumar, for his very interesting presentation about Titanic Quarter. I learned a lot about that, and being Catholic also, I was quite amazed about seeing the discrimination, let's say, that it's quite well known for Ireland, but coming from that time, even within the industry, it was quite interesting to hear and to learn about. I will do a quick presentation, although there's many pages
related, or let's put it there, that's why. About, let's say, a similar projects that is currently happening in Brazil, more specifically in Rio de Janeiro, where I was based in the last 5 years, since August 2010, working with UN Habitat. I've been appointed to the regional office of UN Habitat in Latin America, which is in Rio de Janeiro. And when I came there, I discovered this initiative, which is called in Portuguese Porto Maravilha, which means a marvelous port, let's say. And amazingly, I think it will be one of the questions I will raise about your own experience or your own knowledge. But what I have saw throughout the years is that most of those new initiatives worldwide about regenerating new urban renewal, regenerating specific neighborhoods, most of the time it happens in harbor area. In Rio, it's another example. In my hometown, Montreal, we saw the same also. There was a harbor area totally forgotten, and we saw huge investments from public authorities, sometimes from private sector, aiming at improving and giving a new life to those specific areas. So this Titanic Quarter is another very good example. So we have to question ourselves, let's say, how comes that we see... No, it doesn't work, huh? It's okay. Now let's forget about that. I will say a few words about this project, and we'll open more quickly than expected the question and answers following presentation by Dr. Kumar. But what I want to say about this, let's say, this initiative in Rio is that, like in Ireland, and for the Titanic Quarter initiative projects, it is happening in docklands, where, like in Titanic Quarter, sheds, all this area has to be, have been reclaimed by initiative coming from the city. In that case, they had the milestone to get all the people, all the investments to embark, to get involved in this project was the Olympic Games that will be happening next year in July 2016. So I think they start in 1999 and they saw this specific part of the city of Rio de Janeiro, which is at, let's say, less than 1 kilometer, like in Belfast, of the downtown of Rio, totally empty, with only few ships coming, and no initiatives, desert. And so they decide to create a PPP and to finance all these projects through a consortium that was initiated by the city of Rio, but also with support from the state and from the national government. So that was the first in Brazil, that was the first PPP for urban revitalization. And so they create a consortium with the city of Rio, the government of the Rio de Janeiro. And now it's the biggest in Brazil, the biggest public-private partnership for urban revitalization, and they have now an overall budget of $2.5 billion. It's huge. It's huge. But what is interesting about this initiative, it's much bigger, let's say, in terms of area of the Titanic Quarters. We're talking here about, I just want to make sure about the figures, but I think it's 5 square kilometers big, so it's quite big. So as I was saying, it's very close from downtown. So this part of the city was cut by huge highways and multi-level highways, two levels. So it was impossible for the population to reach the banks of the bay, banks of the river, banks of the sea anymore. So they decide to, among others, because this, as I said, it's $2.5 billion. So they are still doing that. They are doing a huge tunnel that goes below downtown, under downtown. I think it's more than 2 kilometers long, in order that now the population will be able to get access to the banks of the bay and get access to all those historical buildings that will be used, like in the Titanic Quarter, for tourists, for recreative functions, and also environmental purpose. So they are doing that. So not the beauty, but one of the characteristics of this project is how they are financing it. The finance is, in this overall area of Rio, there's a huge and strong regulations about the height of the buildings that investors are allowed to put money in. So they decide to finance this project to create a special tax, let's say, that they call CEPAC, C-E-P-E-C, which describe the name in Portuguese. We can describe translate it in English as Certificates of Additional Construction Potential. So I had very nice slides to show you how it works. But let's say in few words that they decide to create to do a mixed use of the lands, so with commercial possibility of building some commercial buildings, residential building, institutional. So every private promoters who want to build or to renovate a new building in this area, they can decide to go taller than what the municipal regulation is allowing. But in order to do that, they have to pay a special tax to the city, And so far, so good, let's say, until now, all the investments in terms of new roads, etc., has been paid through this special tax that they call a CPAC, Certificates of Additional Construction Potential. So apparently, so far, it costs nothing to the public authorities to do this overall urban renewal. The construction potential is the quantity of square meters that can be constructed on a given piece of land, represented in the square meters of area contained in the building's height and number of floors. So the money that is being raised by the sale of this special tax pays for all the works and services of the project that is called Porto Maravilla for the urban operations. And in this way, the city does not outlay money for the works and also economize on public services. The tax could be different depending of the, as you saw, it's quite a big area, 5 square kilometers. So depending how close you are from the most interesting part, this special tax can vary about 50%. So the preserve, and what is interesting also is that the further part of this area, we are facing slum areas. There's about maybe 15,000 people living in favelas, what we call slums in Brazil. So they are part also of this project. And with this overall funding, they are building, they are upgrading the favelas, but they are also, as you, most of you already know, the experience of Medellin, Colombia. They have built, since Rio is all, it's a hilly city, most of the favelas in Rio, they are on the hills. So they are building peripheric, how do you say, peripheric, in order that people from the favela can get access more quickly to the city, to the downtown. So all those public investments are being financed by this special tax. So unfortunately, you can see all the picture. And they have also built, it has been finished, I think, in August, and this month, a new museum that will be part of this overall program. So as I wanted to show you some parallelism with this initiative and the Titanic Quarter. So before we open the door, the floor, for the questions and answers from Dr. Kumar, I would like to stress out a few keywords or expression that Dr. Kumar has been using, or that to me was quite important. Right from the beginning, he was talking about dead land, useless land, which has now been used to create a new space for the overall population to live in, to work in. So to me, it's a very important. How to start from a useless, from dead lands, and when you have key localization, like the Titanic Quarter area, like in Rio, it was the same. The localization is very, very important. We have to think about that. You have useless land, but depending on the localization, it could be quite easy with wise investments to improve the value of the land and to bring new functions to this land. What I have noticed also through his presentation is that the importance of innovation, creativity, in order to bring up a new vision, new way to add value to this specific area. And what I enjoy, or what I like about also this initiative compared to Rio, they decide to do everything in one phase. Here we can see there's two or three different phases. I think it is a good, wise idea to go in two different phases, because you have to learn, you have to do some lessons and to see for the next phases how to better invest, how to improve this overall initiative. Rio, they are doing it everything in 5 years with huge investments. We're still not sure how sustainable it will be. But in that case, and going into different phases, it gives space, it gives time to authorities, to the population, to assess the situation and to see how to improve it. And one of the questions we have to ask ourselves, you didn't address this issue, Dr. Kumar, is how the local communities were or have to be involved in order to make those different initiatives successful. Okay, so more or less this is what I want to say. So I think we have time now. We have like 15, 20 minutes for questions and answers. So you're welcome.
Thank you for such a nice perspective on the Titanic and Belfast restoring heritage. My name is Pratap Chandani from Green Shakti Foundation. I just wanted to have an idea. You mentioned in one of the slides people living there and people working there. Would you have some, what would be the kind of people working there? And would you have an idea how much percentage of those would be historians who actually conduct the...
For the regeneration.
One would be set of architects, and there would be historians who would do the heritage walks. There'd be theme walks, I'm sure, so as to make the place come alive, and you know, it can spin through your head, you know, the time you're trying to portray or show for 100 years back. So would you have a sense of number of historians working?
Yeah, just to touch base, in fact, thanks for the question. Really speaking, as I said, because it's in a phased form of development, so there's still a lot of areas which has still to be regenerated. And I've just given the images of future planning that the drawing room is critical for the Titanic, which is still being reworked on. Because of the financial crisis, global economic crisis and financial crisis, there have been a lull in it. The whole project was public-private partnership. So investors are there looking at whether they can get the returns for the money they've invested in the first phase. So just to put the record straight. But at this point in time, what we have observed is that the Titanic, as you know, was discovered in the depths of the Atlantic Ocean by Robert Ballard. And Robert Ballard came to inaugurate the Titanic Museum. So I had an opportunity to listen to him of how he discovered the Titanic. So the question, what he has done is, he has brought the entire Titanic artifacts that they found under the sea. He has taken images of that with the submersibles, and he's actually brought it to this museum. So when you're there, you can actually feel like you're standing on the ocean and watching down under the ocean to see all the catastrophic changes that have taken place. But in terms of telling the narrative is very important, and the narrative has been reconstructed based on what the community has. You see, the communities have different approaches to the narrative. And I did not go into too much details, but thanks for reminding me, because you have a narrative from the Protestant community who had the control over the shipping industry. You had a narrative from the people who were completely marginalized, but were working as not just welders, but they were working in the most difficult conditions. You can almost imagine people who worked in the jute, in the Bombay textile industry from 1857 or 1822. Okay, the sort of conditions was horrific. But then there was a narrative from that community as well. But what they have tried to do is, because it is, the Belfast history has been of sectarian conflict, they have been very careful not to mix up, not to show one against the other. So it was a tricky situation of providing a holistic narrative without blaming or pointing fingers, that you have oppressed us for 100 years, so we really need to change that now. So this is a very tricky situation, but that's what the Good Friday Agreement did, that the peace process allowed for a common narrative, for an agreement from both the warring parties to say, let's provide a shared history, a shared narrative, so that we can be proud of the not just the architectural attainment, but also the we can be proud about our skill. It's a shared skill of shipbuilding industry. It was an industrial city. It was one of the most prosperous cities in Europe. So you can see that the narrative is still, as I said, in the construction. My hope is, in the next 20 years, there'll be completely a new generation. I already have students in my class who don't know what the heck is peace process, because they don't even understand what the conflict was about. It's like saying after 70 years of India's independence, in 1947, 2070 will complete 70 years or 75 years. The whole idea is that people born then will have no idea what partition was, or would have no idea what this is all about. So this narrative is on the constant evolution. But at the same time, there is an imperative, there's a social and political imperative not to show down one community against the other.
In fact, I'm going to try and, in our habitat, we've been, some of our members have been active here on restoration projects, Lodi Garden, Limestone, and so on. And I was happy you brought that connection of what India needs to learn. And you say that in New Delhi, and it's almost 100 years of New Delhi, and also 100 years of India Gate built for World War I Memorial. So I'm trying to get sense of, you know, what we can also learn, because our situation, what I saw in restoration of NIUA, it's archaeological survey which does it in a very tight manner, maybe some inputs from perhaps from intact, you know. And there's no community engagement as such. So this is a good way, what you say, peace process between communities, and there's a sense of purpose. So would you like to suggest or sort of reflect what the society here can do, let's say New Delhi, a similar situation, 100 years, looking at Delhi.
Thank you. In fact,
the reason I'm here in India and Delhi was because of the same, exactly for the same purpose, because we were looking at the democratization of heritage. So this is a theme that I've been talking about in Calcutta in the last 2 days and in Delhi as well. The idea that what I have brought in here is, in terms of the research and in engagement, was that we have to democratize heritage. Heritage has somehow become a source of discontent. We do not engage with it. We don't take ownership on it. So this democratization, how is it possible? And I have looked at a simple case example, which I've done for the last 9 months, looking at some of the ancient manuscripts found in the Sundarbans. Okay, the Puthis, those who are familiar with the Bengali old traditional palm leaf manuscripts, the Puthis, which have been in complete disarray. And in the last 3-4 days, that's what I've been trying to engage with. That how do we... I did a small pilot project of just trying to digitize this material. But digitization is not just you take a camera and start shooting. You have to have an aspect of conservation, regeneration, but also bringing the community together. So we ran programs where the community was brought in to show, to tell them how significant this heritage is, to take ownership of this heritage, that they have to identify others which are lying in the private collection, which people don't know, families have disappeared, to really put that together and see how we can save those heritage. So yes, this democratization, someone said, oh, I remember 3 days ago in JNU, I had a Marxist colleague who said, well, this is just using digital and selling it to the global world market. And I said, I'm not going to the World Bank to sell this product, because my approach is very simple, that this material has to be democratized. What's the problem of democratization? If someone can see the value of protecting this heritage through digital media, that is the most important thing for me, because in the next 100 years, you won't live and no one else know what that heritage is all about. So yes, in terms of Delhi's 100 years history, the Delhi Gate, etc., there is lots to be done. And one of the approaches is the use of science and technology, the scientific approaches to conservation and preservation. And the project that I'm proposing is to do something in Banaras, and particularly the term I've used is intercultural entanglements. The idea that you have to understand there are multiple layers of communities existing in those urban spaces or rural spaces. And heritage is not just tangible heritage. Heritage is also about intangible heritage. And as long as we take care of the intangible heritage, as much as the tangible heritage, we have a common purpose, a common goal towards sustaining that particular sector. So yes, we have a lot to do. I mean, including looking at the artisans. Today, their program is largely based on constructing toilets and roads and nothing else. It's just the bricks and mortars. I understand that is also relevant, but people are not trained to do heritage. We do not have anything being taught in the universities which talks about trained heritage. Today, in the West, in the UK, we have moved into providing GIS and digital heritage. We are using 3D scanners to provide non-invasive technologies. By scanning the building from outside, we are able to provide information about the degradation of the products, of the materials. What is it that you need? We don't have that scientific knowledge. I know Aga Khan Trust has done some work on Humayun Tomb with architectural historians, perfectly fine, but that's just the beginning. That's just a drop in the ocean. We need to train people to do that.
Also, two things. One is there's the hardware portion to restore, but the software portion where you need these passionate historians to bring soul into it, bring soul back to make it come alive. We don't seem to have much budget for that, or even in our approach. And second thing is, we have a very young population. 65% India is too young. Some of our cyclists I take them around weekends and other things. 60% listen, 40% yawn. So how do you, get the youngsters interested?
In Belfast, what we have been doing is that we have something
called the Centre for Archaeological Studies, and we have run programs for school children. We start very young. We take them to the digs. We get them to understand what is this material culture, how does it relate to their lives, and then we bring them back to understand the relevance of this. And some of them have gone on to become archaeologists. They've gone on to do work on conservation. But as I said, it is building it up from the grassroots level. Yes, history, people do not have a sense of history because people have very short memory span. We spend more time on the computers and on the iPads and phones. So the general life's memory span is very limited. Historians want to become IAS officers. So historians are not there to work on the heritage. Okay, so you need someone really passionate enough. I'm not saying you should not become an IAS officer.
You can't be full-time. Yeah. There's no budgetary support.
No. But it is a passion. It's a passion that you can continue. If you go to Zurich, you'll find that people... just 2 seconds. If you go to Zurich, you'll find people taking this walking tours. Even in Belfast, they have walking tours. You have a pub crawl, a pub tour. You have tours looking at ghost stories. Something which is related to the community and what they believe in, what is their sense of purpose. So those things can be incorporated. But we have to look at... I always say in the heritage sector, we have to poach the best practices. You have to push the best practices.
Yeah, you talk about 3D scanning. Are you using 3D printing also?
Yes.
In what way?
We use 3D printing to provide molds of scanned materials
and then sell it. We also provide it as a gift to school children. So they could do an exercise of a 3D scanning of one of the images which you cannot touch. For instance, the dancing lady of Mohenjo-daro. Okay? And that becomes a hard artifact which you can use for printing and carry it forward.
So, but in your Belfast project, yeah, you're using it for making models of the building?
They do use for building models of the project. But we use, in fact, with the 3D scanners, we have, a PowerPoint somewhere where we actually use those materials to identify, as I said, how the points provide, and we link it up with the GIS system. So you can actually, it's an integrated system, not just per se 3D. Yeah.
You're referring to that as GIS.
GIS. But GIS is geographical information systems using spatial statistics, but also integrating all the various informations, data that we have, to provide a holistic image to the whole thing. So it's quite integrated, it's not independent.
Okay. And at some stage, you think it will be possible using concrete as a material to do 3D printing of actual buildings? Actually, build a building using 3D printing?
I think it can be. I mean, if you look at the recent efforts in the Bamiyan caves, where they've used the 3D to recreate or reconstruct what has been destroyed by the Taliban, it's quite an interesting example. But yes, in terms of the building, we have used it for old castles. We have recreated old churches, old castles, in terms of 3D structures, but also identifying areas for intervention without necessarily blocking. I mean, if you look at some of the historical buildings that we have in Delhi, I always see that some of the areas, they've defaced it. They put some completely irrelevant materials. And you ask the question, why can't someone be sensible? You give it to a contractor, you got a tender, you put a couple of cement and some sandwood there, and that's it done. There's no understanding of what is there, what the heritage should be.
They
use 3D printing to make a model of the actual building. They also use it on the computers as a scanner because you have to look at it in all dimensions. So you can rotate it around. I mean, I could show that if I had it with me, how the building looks at it just as a visual.
But you're saying it can be used to also actually make a building?
Not to make a building. No, you cannot you can make it as a construct for construction purposes. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
They're using it. We have churches which are almost 300 years old church. We do the complete 3D scanning and then identify areas where you can actually transform, where you want to intervene. It's now become an essential part of architecture and reconstruction and regeneration, especially LiDAR and all the other images.
If there are no real questions, then we probably... is there anything that Alan would like to add or anyone?
No, not really, no.
Okay, so we could probably close the session for today.
Oh, well, let me finish it by, sorry, because as I said, I was learning a lot today about the new reality or new perspective about the Titanic sinking. So I would just want to add to this story or a new version, a new perception of this. And on behalf of all Canadians, I want you to convey my message to all Irish people, because we know it's because of a Canadian iceberg that this ship sank, so we want to apologize.
That's why I started my talk by saying it was built by the Irish, but was sunk by the British.
Canadian iceberg.
But that's the sectarian element, I would say, sort of an undertone or overtone of what was happening in the real world. There were a lot of cross currents, undercurrents. Thank you very much for attending this evening.
The next one is on 18th of September. We have this every month, so it's normally third Friday. So the next one will be on 18th of September, certainly would be delighted to have you. And if you could extend the invitation to your wider circles, that would be great. I think today is probably one of the thin days where we used to have 60 plus people, but apparently today, for various reasons, we have a very number of people. Thank you once again for being here.
Thank you to you.